Okay, I've been dragging this on for a while now, but we finally do our first hack. I know you have been waiting for this, but it's important for me to show each step along the way because you can't just jump straight to the hacking stuff. A huge hidden chunk of hacking is about studying, gathering information, testing, engineering, and so forth. I think this tweet captures it perfectly. I'm starting to think that hacking isn't about tech skill, it's being willing to stare at a screen for hours, try a million things, feel stupid, get mad, decide to eat a sandwich instead of throwing your laptop out a window, Google more, figure it out, and then want to do it again. So yeah, don't be impatient, we get there eventually. At the end of last video, I said that we can easily extract class information from GDB with ptype. And that is mostly true, but there are a few caveats. So let's start by copying a few classes into our header file and include it in an empty program, then try to compile it. This will reveal a lot of new classes that are referenced by the current classes, and we can use that to extract even more. Or we learn about basic classes like strings we need to import. And maybe some other minor mistakes like missing semicolons. There are also some GDB errors like this Python exception produced by GDB in the middle of those classes, so those have to be removed as well. But at some point we gathered all the information needed to compile it. But what can we do with this now? There's something called LD preload. LD preload is an environment variable interpreted by the Linux Dynamic Linker Loader, the LDSO library that basically every program you execute uses. You can also read the man page of it, man LDSO. The program LDSO finds and loads shared objects, shared libraries, needed by a program, prepare the program to run, and then run it. Linux binaries require dynamic linking at runtime, unless the minus-static option was given to LD during compilation. And in there, you can also find information about the LD preload environment variable. LD preload, a list of additional user-specified ELF shared objects to be loaded before all others. This can be used to selectively override functions in other shared objects. That sounds really amazing, right? We can use that to force the game to load any shared object that we want before other shared objects. So we could create our own library, load it before the shared object lib game logic, and override functions from that. To do that, we simply have to compile our program as a shared object instead. So with minus shared, the resulting binary is not an executable anymore, but a shared object. And you can check that out now with LDD, which shows the dynamic libraries loaded by this program. And if we add the LD preload environment variable with our compiled shared object, suddenly the game also loads our test shared object. Cool, right? This means we can include any code we want in it, and it will get loaded into the process as part of loading the dynamic libraries that implement functions used by the program. That means that we can, for example, define a function playerSetJumpState, and when the program wants to use this function, which it wants to call inside an external dynamic library, then it will find ours and not the intended one from libgamelogic. So let's add some test printf output here, which also prints the bool parameter given to this function. Oh, if you define a function like that now, you also need to compile it with pic, position independent code. So it can be loaded anywhere in memory. Now let's try it. Let's start the game with LD preloading our test shared object. We go into the game, and when we jump, we see the function being called. Isn't that awesome? In fact, we set the jump state to 1 when we start to jump, and when we land, it gets set to 0 again. That's so awesome. Though, there's one tiny problem here. You see, we overwrite this function. And from last episode, we know that it would lead to inform the server of the jump. So if I log into the game on another computer and look at this character, I see no jumping at all. The server never gets the information that we jumped. And when we remove the LD preload again and now run the program and uses the real setJumpState function, we can see that the player is jumping again. So that is a problem, or can be a problem depending on what you want to do. But we deal with calling the intended function when we need it. For now, let's keep it a bit more simple. Remember the game world global variable, which has a reference to the currently active player or all other players in the world and much more? I think it would be super cool to interact with that object. While investigating the classes, I found this tick function that exists for a lot of objects. The client world tick is executed multiple times a second and it calls a lot of other tick functions. One of them is the world tick, which appears to do nothing. So because it's constantly called and it does nothing else, it's a perfect candidate to be replaced. So let's do that. But what can we do in it? So there's a function called dlsym. It obtains the address of a symbol in a shared object or executable, and it takes two parameters, a handle and the name of a symbol. The handle could be a handle to an open dynamic library, but we can also use rtld next, which will find the next occurrence of the desired symbol in search order after the current object. This is actually also the solution for the previous problem, but like I said, we deal with that when we have to. But just for completeness sake, this allows one to provide a wrapper around a function in another shared object so that, for example, the definition of a function in a preloaded shared object can find and invoke the real function provided in another shared object. But we will use it to get the address of the game world symbol. And the game world symbol is an address where we have a pointer to a client world object, which means game world is a pointer to a client world pointer. Because dlsym doesn't know that and just returns a void pointer, essentially an address, we have to cast it to a client world pointer. And then we dereference that to obtain a direct client world pointer. And then we should have access to the whole object and its attributes. And we can write something like this. So we take the world object and get the currently active player, which should be us. We can also do this in GDB to figure out what exactly we have to do. And it's a very fun way to explore the objects. So the active player is this actor ref with a mObject attribute, which is then our player, or almost our player. We have to cast that iPlayer to an actual player object. And then we can, for example, call the getPlayerName function to print the name. Or we can access the amount of mana. If we compile this now and execute the game while we LD preload this, we should see the mana and name of our player. And it almost works. We see our name, the character name is ASD, but the mana is 0? That doesn't look right. Especially because with GDB we can confirm that the player object should hold our amount of mana. So something goes wrong. Let me show you what the fix for that was. So GDB reported these attributes to be of the type stdString, but in reality they were const char pointers. Replacing them makes it work. And why that was an issue is that this stdString type takes more space in the class structure than a simple pointer would. So these other attributes of type stdstrings push down the, for example, mana attribute, and so based on our header file, the compiler thought the player mana is much further down in memory than where it actually was. And debugging this, because I have almost no C++ experience and doing this for the first time, took me around 8 to 10 hours. I'm not kidding, this small change to fix this blocked me more than a full day worth of work. Thinking about this is just so sad, but on the other hand, I really learned a lot during this process. This is a topic I don't know a lot about. This is the first time that I really look at C++ objects and classes in memory. So during this painful process, I actually learned a lot. I mean, I can't even summarize all the stuff I tried and investigated in those 10 hours, but the breakthrough came from combining two observations. One was when I was looking at the offsets to the mana attribute from the start of the class, where GDB thinks the mana should be and where our compiled library thinks it should be. And noticing the GDB error when printing the object, that something is not quite right there. Still took me quite a while to figure out what exactly it is, but yeah, reversing and hacking can be really painful, but very rewarding if you get it at the end. So what can we do with that now? I promised you a first hack in this video. If you had a close look at the player class, you may have seen an attribute called walking speed. So we could try to set the walking speed to a super high value. So what will that do? Let's compile the library again, LD preload, and start the game. So let's try to walk a little and whoosh, look at that speed. We are so fast, we can even take over our fireballs. That's so awesome. But there are even more attributes. There was also a player health. Can we make us invincible? Let's try to always set our player health to over 99,000. If we try to compile it now, then we can't access the health attribute directly because it's a protected attribute. But you know, there's no such thing as a protected by some kind of magic memory. This is just C++ convention, and so if we change this in our header file to public, then the compiler allows us to access it and won't throw an error. And now we can compile it and head into the game. Ha! Look, our health doesn't even fit on the display anymore. So let's go to the chest protected by bears. Thanks to our walking speed hack, we are super fast. And now, when we try to open the chest for the flag, a timer will start and bears will attack us. But we have so much health now, you can't do anything. Wahaha! Look, we are invincible. You have died, killed by a bear. Oh. Well, you see, it's not that easy. Apparently, the game server trusts the player position sent to the server, and thus we can walk super, super fast. The server just accepts these new positions even when they are unrealistically far away from the previous one, but it doesn't get fooled by our health. So clearly, the server keeps track of what our health should be and the damage we get. So we can set the health super high on the client, it just doesn't help us at all. But with the power to change values of our player object and even other stuff in the world, you can still achieve a lot.